Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Easter worship at St. Andrew's United Methodist Church. Greetings in the name of Jesus Christ to all of you who have been able to join us here in the great room of our Family Life Center. We're back inside God's house for the first time in over a year. Let's show our appreciation to the Lord for bringing us through to this point. Greetings also to those who are following us on Facebook Live. We will be streaming our services from this point forward as we also have worship here in this space. Hold your head high. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Rejoice and shout. Christ has called us home. Home to the heart of God. Home to God's living presence. Home to God's house. Hold your head high. Christ has risen.
He is risen indeed.
Death has been conquered. Christ has called us home. All that was broken has been made whole. All that was dislocated has been set right. All that was oppressed has been set free. Hold your head high. Christ has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Bringing God's healing, God has called us home. Redemption is complete. God's eternal world has begun. Love reigns over all. Christ is risen.
He
is risen indeed. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ has called us home. Amen. It is so good to see you this morning. It's so good to see so many new faces. A lot of you I don't know, and I hope I will get to know you, but I'm glad you were able to be with us today. A couple of things. There have been questions. Are we having communion today on the first Sunday back? And the answer is no. We didn't want to overcomplicate it. So we will be having communion in the near future. It will be with the individually packaged communion supplies, because that's what we'll need to do for a while until it's safe for us to do it otherwise. Please remember to keep your masks on while you're inside the building. Reopening. This is what we will be doing from now on. We'll be meeting in this space because we can spread everybody out and have more people here than we could in the sanctuary. Also, the ceilings are higher and the airflow is better in here, and it's easier for us to control access in and out, and there's more room for people to come in and out. So we'll be using this space until we can probably gather together without masks again, and when that day comes, then we'll be able to go back into our sanctuary. Although it is not impossible that we could meet in the sanctuary in smaller groups for other things before that time, our reopening task force will have to look at that. Let me remind you that we're going to be using a reservation system for now because we do have a capacity limit in here. And until that limit is lifted, we'll ask that you get reservations the way that you did this past week by calling the church office or using the online form to let us know that you would like to be here this coming Sunday. Let's see. The coffee talk and bingo will resume this coming Thursday. We didn't have it last week because of Maundy Thursday. You see the beautiful Easter lilies here. You'll be invited to take those home with you as you are dismissed. And what we'll do is we'll dismiss everybody from the front, a group at a time, so that we're socially distanced when we leave. And when it's your turn to be dismissed, you're welcome to take your lily with you on your way out. But we do want those because they're not probably won't get watered this week if they're left here. The office will be closed this coming week because there won't be anybody there. Teresa and I are both going to be on vacation this coming week. And so if you want to make your reservations, there will be somebody checking the phone messages and the email to make sure that we have a record of all of that. If you need to get in touch with me in an emergency over the next week, you can call my phone number or text me or send me an email message or one of the other church leaders, and they'll make sure that I get it. So you will be able to contact me in the event of an emergency over the next week. Let's move to our joys and celebrations now. First, last Sunday was New Consecration Sunday, and we gathered in the parking lot and had a meal together, and it was an outstanding group of folks and a big gathering, and we were really glad to see everybody come out. We don't have the results on that yet, and we won't for a while, because we're going to be sending cards out in the mail to those who could not be here or for some reason, so they have an opportunity to participate as well in that. So we will be giving you the result of that as soon as we know it. It may be a while. It's a little different year. Remember the last time we did that, we had a result before we left the property that afternoon, but we'll get it to you as soon as we can. Some good news, though. Our first small business loan that we got, because we qualified as a small business because we have personnel, and bills to pay. Our first one has been forgiven. So the money that the government loaned us has been forgiven. We don't have to pay that back, and we're grateful to God for that and for that's being provided. And the second one has been deposited in the bank. And so we will have an extra financial resource to rely on in the year ahead, and we're very grateful for that. Let's see. I want to thank, this has been a long year, and I've done this before. I want to do it again, especially the last month or so. A lot of work has been going on behind the scenes, and I want to thank everybody who's been a part of all of it. The last week has been very busy, especially. So a lot of folks were at work, not just on email, but also here in the building, trying to get everything ready. And I especially want to thank the Reopening Task Force, who has been on the job for the last year, trying to make sure that we stay safe. And we are glad to report that because of our activities, because of our discernment and our caution, there has not been a single infection that can be traced to any church activity, and that was our goal from the start. And we give God thanks for that. And I want us to show our appreciation to our Reopening Task Force right now, if we can. Let's move now to concerns. We want to lift up all of those who have lost loved ones in our church family recently. Let's continue to pray for Lisa Anthony, who is receiving treatments for cancer. She's had half of her chemotherapy treatments, and they usually knock her back pretty hard about a week after she's had a treatment. But we did see Lisa and Phil last Thursday night on the Maundy Thursday Zoom. The Youngblood family asks for prayers today for Betsy's mother, Eleanor, for their grandnephew, Lane Youngblood, a four-year-old who has cancer. He's had to have a kidney removed. And also prayers for Betsy, who has surgery coming up this next week. Let's continue to pray for Artis. Artis is here today. She's had surgery and is recovering, is on the mend, and we're glad to see both of you here today. Let's continue to pray for those who are in hospitals or rehab centers, and that would include Richard Stone, who's been moved to a different rehab. That would include Tommy Creech, Mary Ellen Creech's husband, who is still in the hospital getting tested. That would include Marie Stranded. And also John Robinson. So be in prayers for all of those people. We also want to lift up Ron Morrow and Carol Harris and Linda Wiggs and Don Aldridge and others who have been suffering from health problems recently. We ask for prayers for their healing. We want to lift up this morning those who really wanted to be here but could not for some reason. In some cases, they were out of town. In other cases, they haven't received their vaccinations or they're not yet comfortable being out in with other people, and we certainly understand that. We don't want anybody to feel like they have to come and be a part of anything that we do until they feel safe. So we want to lift all of them up, and we hope that they're watching us on Facebook or will be watching us later. We want to lift up our country as it seems that as we get back to normal, the violence has started again, and we certainly want to pray especially for the family of the officer, Capitol Police officer, who was killed in Washington, D.C. a couple of days ago. We want to pray for the families of the four young people who were killed in Wilmington in a shooting at a party the other night. We want to pray for all of those who are continuing to look for vaccinations. And there are a couple of places in the United States that are in a surge mode again. Michigan would be one of them, and I believe they're in a surge mode in Florida. We're hoping that that will not happen here in North Carolina if we continue to observe social distancing, wear masks, and get our vaccinations. In the world, though, there are many places that have not been able to get vaccinations to the level that we have, and that would include places like France and Germany, who are now having to lock down again because of new waves of the virus, especially the variants that are apparently more contagious, about the same level of lethality, which makes them about 50 times more deadly than the flu. So we want to pray for those countries that are fighting it. Brazil in particular, right now, the virus is out of control completely. So we want to pray for the people of Brazil who are sort of at the mercy of everything that's going on around them. And let's remember to pray for the people of Myanmar, where the army has taken over the government, and there's a lot of bloodshed. And also the good people of Artsakh in Armenia, particularly our Methodist brothers and sisters over there who have had to move all of their operations to a different place because of the civil war that's going on. There may be other concerns. Keep those in your heart, and we'll lift them up later in a time of prayer. I want to thank all of you for your generosity and continuing to support our mission and ministry, not just through the pandemic, but in all that you do. And if you want to continue to support us financially, there is an offering basket at the back. And as you're leaving today, you're welcome to put something in there if you'd like to, or you can put a check in our locked mailbox out in front of the church. It is secure. Or you can bring it by the church or mail it to the church, 1201 Maxwell Drive, Raleigh, North Carolina, 27603. Or you can go to our church website, www.standrewsumc.org, and go through the process of setting up online giving, or you can make a one-time gift simply by clicking on the green button at the top. Again, thank you so much for your support, for your prayers, and for all that you do to keep us a force and an influence in our community. God bless you.
Danced in the morning when the world was begun. I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun. I came down from heaven and danced on the earth at Bethlehem. That's where I had my birth. Dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of dance, said he. And I will lead you all in a dance, said he. And he said, the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me and the dance still goes on and on. Dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of dance, said he. Now I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. And he said, danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people said, well, they said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped me and they hung me high and they left me there, left me on a cross to die. Dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of dance, said he. Now I'll lead you on in a dance, said he. He said, thank you. cut me down, and I leapt up high, because I am the life, and I'll never ever die. I'll live in you, if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dancing. Dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of dancing. And I will lead you all in the dance, said he. He says,
amen. Our scripture today comes from the ending of the gospel according to Mark. Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He's not here. Look, there's the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Each of the four Gospels has an account of the resurrection of Jesus, and each story is a little different. In Matthew's version, from Matthew 28, which I read this morning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, we're told, go to the tomb Sunday morning. While they're there, an angel comes down from heaven and causes an earthquake that opens the tomb. The angel tells them the tomb is empty because Jesus has risen. He invites them to look inside to see for themselves, but the story doesn't say they ever did this. He also tells them to inform the disciples what's happened and to go to Galilee. And just as the women are hurrying away, the risen Christ meets them and also tells them they should go to tell the disciples to go to Galilee to meet him there. In Matthew's version, the chief priest, upon hearing from the Roman guards that Jesus has risen, orders the soldiers to lie and tell everybody that the disciples stole the body. That's Matthew's version. In Luke's version, an unspecified number of women, including Mary Magdalene, go to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus for burial. There's no angel. The stone has been rolled away. When they go inside and find the body missing, two men in bright clothing suddenly appear in their midst. The women are terrified, but the glowing men tell them not to be afraid because Jesus had told them all along that this would happen. The women return and tell the disciples that Jesus has risen, but their story is not believed. But Peter goes to look for himself and finds the tomb empty, just as the women had said. In John's version, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb by herself. She finds the stone rolled away and the tomb empty, but instead of going inside to look around, she runs back and finds Peter and John and tells them what's happened. The two disciples investigate and find the burial linens that Jesus had been placed in. Then they run back to tell the others that Jesus has risen. Mary, who had apparently gone back to the tomb with the men, she stays there and cries, unable to understand anything that's going on. She finally gets up the nerve to look inside the tomb and sees two angels dressed in white seated on the stone bench where Jesus' body has been laid. They ask her why she's crying. And she says, "Somebody's taken the master's body away. And then she turns around and sees a man who had been standing behind her. For some reason, maybe it was too dark in the tomb to make him out, Mary doesn't recognize him. She thinks he might be the gardener and wants to know if he moved the body. And the man says her name, and she instantly recognizes from his voice that it's Jesus. And he tells her to go back to the disciples to tell them that he is risen. It's the same basic story in all the versions, but the details don't match. Critics of Christianity throughout history have claimed that the inconsistencies prove that the whole thing was just made up. But the truth is a lot more mundane. If you ask three people who saw the events of September the 11th, 2001 on television, if you ask them what happened, I guarantee you that their stories are not going to match, especially after 20 years. If you ask an actual eyewitness who was there, the stories are going to diverge even more. It's human nature for us not to recall things in perfect photographic detail. Our difficulty in remembering is compounded when the events are unprecedented or tragic. So remember, the Gospels are not history. These four documents, 2,000-year-old documents, were not newspaper articles that were written by trained journalists. They are ancient biographies of Jesus, and each one was written to bring out a different, distinct aspect of his life. We can only say for sure that one or more women, including Mary Magdalene, went to the tomb early Sunday morning and found it empty. There were one or more angels or glowing men present who may have been responsible for moving the stone away from the door. One or more women were instructed to go tell the male disciples who may not have even believed them and may or may not have gone back to the tomb themselves. Only Mary Magdalene is said to have actually seen the risen Christ on that first Easter morning. The bottom line is the body of Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was executed on Friday afternoon, was not in the place where he had been put on Friday evening. And inexplicable circumstances that followed that led the disciples to believe that he had come back to life. Now, I haven't even mentioned Mark's version yet, the one that I read. It's the strangest of the four, and it's also the oldest of the four. According to Mark, who was thought to be a protege of Peter, and so Mark got his information directly from Peter, according to Mark, three women, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, went to the tomb early Sunday morning to anoint the body of Jesus. They were going there to embalm him with spices to keep his body from smelling bad while he lay there in the tomb. And when they got there, they found the stone already rolled away. They went inside and they saw a young man dressed all in white sitting on the stone bench. And he apparently could see the look on their faces, a look of fear. So he told them not to be afraid because Jesus had risen from the dead. And he told them to go back and tell the disciples and Peter to go to Galilee to meet the risen Lord. But the women didn't do that. Instead, they ran away because the whole thing terrified them. And I quote, "They said nothing to anyone." In other words, they didn't go back to tell the disciples that Jesus wasn't in the tomb. The men somehow found out later, but Mark doesn't tell us that part of the story. Apparently he wasn't interested in it. He just leaves us hanging in the air with three women scared out of their wits running away from the tomb. Now, if you are embellishing a story when you tell it, you don't usually make it less believable. You don't usually make the main characters less admirable. In Mark's abrupt ending to the Easter story, the disciples never make it to the tomb, and Jesus never actually appears. And this tells me that Mark's version is probably close to what actually happened, with the other Gospels adding or changing things after years and years of telling and retelling the story. And this bothers a lot of people, which is why you may have never heard an Easter sermon based on Mark's version of the resurrection story. We don't like things that end in the middle of the story. Now, don't feel bad if the ending of Mark disturbs you. People back in the early days of the church didn't like it either, so they wrote two other endings to Mark's gospel. The 400-year-old King James Version contains one of those alternate endings, But today we know, unlike they did back then, we know that that was added later. It wasn't part of the original story because the oldest manuscripts we found end at verse 8 with the women running away. So rather than second-guess Mark's storytelling abilities, let's assume he had a reason for telling the story the way he did. What did he hope future readers like us would discern from this sudden ending? Let's take his account a step at a time. The angel tells them to go back to Galilee to see the risen Christ. Jesus wants the disciples, including the women, not just the men, to go back to where the story all started. Remember, it was at the Sea of Galilee where Jesus first called Peter and Andrew to become fishers of men. Jesus wants everybody to go back where it all started. What if that invitation to go back to the beginning wasn't just for them? What if it was for us too? What if Jesus wants us to enter the story and make the same journey the disciples did? Now, I'm not suggesting that we all get on an airplane and fly to Israel. I don't mean literally go to Galilee, but what is your Galilee? Where did your journey with Jesus start? And what is your Jerusalem, where Jesus' earthly story ended? Where in your journey did you become disillusioned or feel abandoned or lose hope? Now, for some of you, the journey with Jesus may not have started yet. You haven't yet answered that call to follow. Maybe you've heard it, but you haven't recognized it for what it is. And if that's you, you can start the journey anytime. You can start it today. If you want to start that journey today, you can come up here and see me during the closing song, or you can contact me or some other Christian you trust at any time. Other folks can give the day and the hour when they joined Jesus, but they might not have ever thought about having a Calvary moment in their life, a moment when faith seems like a cruel joke, unless that is they've lost somebody they love. It can be hard to believe in resurrection when you're looking at the lifeless body of your spouse or your partner or your child or your parent or your close friend. It takes a huge leap of faith to believe at that moment that death is not the end of the story. And not everybody who claims to follow Jesus has actually made that leap. Let's assume Mark wants us to, metaphorically speaking, join those women at the tomb. Imagine being told that not only was the story of Jesus not over, it was only beginning. It was starting again. The empty tomb wasn't the last chapter of anything. It was merely the closing paragraph of the first chapter of everything. I really can't blame them for being confused and scared. Remember what they had already been through with Jesus. They had been through the ups and now the very lowest of the lows, the worst downs. And now they were being told to go back to the starting line to await further instructions. I think I would have been confused and maybe a little scared too. What if Mark's abrupt, apparently incomplete ending isn't a puzzle for us to solve, though? What if it's an invitation? 33 years ago, a theologian named Ched Myers wrote a book called Binding the Strong Man. According to Myers, Mark intended for us to step into his gospel and complete it by following Jesus within the context of our own lives. Here's a quote. The disciple or reader is being told that the narrative, which appeared to have ended, is beginning again. Myers says the life of Jesus ended neither in triumphal victory, as the disciples hoped, nor with a restored Israel, as the political rebels like Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot had desired, nor in tragic failure and defeat, as those who are reading the story might fear. Instead, the crucifixion led to a renewal of Jesus' mission in another form, one that would be lived out through the lives of his followers. The invitation by the angel to go to Galilee is a last call to discipleship. It echoes the first one made at the beginning of the Gospel of Mark, there at the Sea of Galilee, to Peter and Andrew. except now the invitation is for anybody who's hearing the story. But, Myers writes, Mark does not leave us with a happy ending. He continues, quote, "We do not entirely understand what resurrection means. But if we have understood the story, we should be holding fast to what we do know, that Jesus still goes before us, summoning us to the way of the cross. And that's the hardest ending of all. Not tragedy, not victory, but an unending challenge to follow him. Because that means we must respond. For Mark, the resurrection is not an answer, but the final question. There's only one genuine witness to the risen Jesus, to follow him in discipleship. Only in this way will the truth of the resurrection be preserved." The resurrection as a question, not as an answer. The empty tomb and the invitation to go back to the beginning are clear signs that the story is not over yet. It's beginning again, and you and I are called to step into it. To better illustrate what he's getting at, Myers discusses a brilliant 1979 children's novel called The Neverending Story. It was turned into a movie. Many of you may be familiar with that. The story is about a lonely, unhappy boy who finds himself locked overnight in a bookstore. He picks up this huge fantasy book about a life and death struggle between good and evil, and the tale is so compelling that he can't put it down. As he gets drawn deeper and deeper into the story, he gets this weird feeling that the characters in the book want him to join their fight. And as soon as he realizes that they really do need his help, he reads his own name in the book. And he then steps into the story to join the battle for goodness and justice. And when he does that, his life is changed forever. And Myers writes, "In similar fashion, Mark's narrative of discipleship can continue only if we realize that we are in fact characters in the story we thought we were reading." Today, I tell you, friends, that the story of Jesus Christ is the true never-ending story. The characters in the gospel want us to join their mission to share God's love. We're called to step into the gospel and become part of it. The Bible is a dangerous book. It has a power that other great written works lack. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, God's Word comes alive. It beckons us to read it. And when we do, when we hear it read, we can't simply close it and put it away. For the story that it tells has not ended yet. It's only just begun. And we were put into this world by the author of the story to become part of the story. What does a person's life look like when they step into the gospel? I could tell you stories all day, but I know you have other places to be this afternoon, so I'm going to limit myself to just one. My friend Gary Wayne Locklear, who died of COVID-19 in September, had worked in human resources development for 27 years when he heard the call to step deeper into Christian ministry. I first met him as a member of the conference connectional table a long time ago. He was a tall giant of a man. He was probably 6'8". He was kind, he was gentle, he was soft-spoken, and his heart was broken by human suffering, especially the poverty and the crime and the misery of his own Lumbee people in Robeson County. He became a home missioner, an unordained missionary within his own community. He was a Robeson County church and community worker. He was a member of the Rural Life Chaplains Association and the Native American Cooperative Ministry. He was a lifetime member of Sandy Plains United Methodist Church, where he taught Sunday school and Bible study for over 50 years. He was part of mission teams in Robeson County, in South Carolina, in Alaska, in Guatemala, and in Russia. His work in Bolivia was crucial in founding a rural health clinic that now serves 50,000 people. Gary even served as the lay leader for the entire North Carolina Conference. Now, you may say after hearing that, I can't do all of that. I'm not special. But Gary would have been the first to tell you he was just an ordinary guy. Nothing special. He simply heard Jesus call his name from the pages of the Gospels, and he stepped into the story. And now Gary himself is part of the never-ending story, and his memory lives forever in God. Stepping into the gospel of God need not be spectacular. You don't have to be the conference lay leader. You don't have to teach Sunday school for 50 years. You certainly don't have to be ordained. You simply have to recognize that the Lord invites you to make your story part of His. And your part of the story can be as simple as sewing clothing for poor children. It can be as simple as donating food for the hungry. It can be as simple as visiting men and women in prison. It can be as simple as running the AV equipment at a worship service. It can be as simple as cooking meals for people who have been hospitalized or for families that have lost a loved one. It could be as simple as praying for other people from the bed of the nursing home that you're in. And I could go on and on and on. Each of us has a different, unique role to step into, one that will bless others and bless us. When you enter this story, you take on the same mission as those in the pages of Scripture, to love other people through what you say and do, from your everyday work to your life within a community of faith. Christian discipleship is not about getting your own needs met or your own wants satisfied. It's not about being thanked or recognized for your contributions. Discipleship is selfless service to others, letting Christ's love flow through your life so that both the people that you help and you are transformed. That's how resurrection works. If we enter the never-ending story, we're going to experience everything Jesus did in our own way. We're going to have our Bethlehem moments of hope and new life. We're going to have our wilderness chapters of temptation and isolation. We're going to have episodes of disappointment with our family and our friends. We're going to be loved and we may be betrayed. And yes, we're going to have good Fridays of death and darkness and loss. But we're promised that Friday is never the end. Sunday is always coming. Our story, you see, is never ending too. You and I are actors in a great drama. Some of us enjoy active and effective lives of service while others struggle in the wilderness. Some experience terrible suffering while others feel as if they've been raised from the dead. Some people are so exhausted they feel they might as well be dead. They're waiting to be raised from the tomb. But we are all part of one great story. And in every human life, the story is being played out in some form. In every person, the way of Jesus is either honored or despised, loved or rejected, even by those who have never heard His name. This Easter, I hope that we will reflect on how well we are entering the greatest story ever told. Are we making the Lord's story our own? Are we continuing His work of love by bringing the gospel alive again in our time? Let us each plunge into the never-ending story and discover anew that Christ the Lord is risen today. He is risen indeed. Alleluia and amen.
Yeah.
Let us pray. Almighty God, with faces touched by the light of a new day and hearts warmed by our prayers and praises, we come before you to pray for the needs of our world. Into the light of Easter morning, we raise up those who are struggling with illness. We raise up those who despair over their lives. We lift up especially those whose names we called aloud earlier in our service. And now, in a moment of silence, we lift up all of those other persons and situations that we want to bring before you. Hear us now in the silence of this place. Into the light of Easter morning, we pray for those who do not share our Easter joy. We pray for those who live in the shadow of darkness and despair, for those who live with the hopelessness of shattered dreams and trust betrayed and opportunities lost and love denied. We pray for those who live without faith or hope or love, who see no resurrection and no hope of new beginnings for themselves or for the world. May the light of Christ shine upon them. Into the light of Easter morning, we bring those places in our world where poverty and need are things of everyday life. We pray especially for the little children and for the elderly who don't have enough to eat or a comfortable place to lay their head or the medicine that they need to be healthy or people who love them and take care of them. May the light of Christ shine upon them. Into the light of Easter morning, we hold in our hearts the pain of those suffering from violence or conflict. We lift up the family members of all of those who have been taken so suddenly from the mass shootings recently. We lift up the family members of our law enforcement personnel who have lost their lives in the service of their duty. We lift up the people of Myanmar and Artsakh and other places around the world racked by war. May the light of Christ shine upon them. And into the light of Easter morning, we bring ourselves, our own private struggles, our heart's yearnings, our hidden dreams, and our own unfulfilled potential. May the light of Christ shine upon each one of us too. And may we pray together using the words Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now the pastor's calling an audible, so I'm going to ask you to do something, and I hope you will all follow instructions. If you were able to do so, I would like you to stand up. Do not take your mask off. If you can't stand up, that's okay, I understand. Stand up if you can, keeping your mask on, and I want you to turn where you are, and I want you to greet the people around you, to say hello, happy Easter, God be with you. No touching. This is the COVID passing of the peace. If you'll turn back towards me now, and you may stay standing. God of creation, creating anew, the silence has been broken. With the women in the garden, we catch our breath and wipe our tears. What words can describe shadows fleeing from the tomb? How can we speak of the morning the world turned upside down? No mortal words will do. Still, we must spread the news. Christ the Lord is risen today. Our knees are weak from running. Our voices tremble on the edge of fearful joy. Our eyes have seen the glory of the Lord loosed upon the world. From this morning forward, may every breath we take and every word we utter and everything we do witness to the truth of Christ's resurrection. Amen and amen. Now, if you would be seated, The ushers will begin to lead you out a group at a time.